Okay. Hi, my name is Nora and I will be presenting on tea and colonialism. I just wanted to quickly thank all the participants, including Cassandra and James, for inviting me to speak today. And I have learned a great deal about food and colonialism from all our esteemed panelists. So I will start by talking about tea in the sense of like it's the second most popular drink in the world. And chances are you probably had it this morning. I know I did. This is my cup and I'm still having tea. It's very, very pervasive. The culture is pervasive. And when I was asked to give this talk, doing a little bit of research really made me understand how, where the roots of tea are and how we've kind of taken for granted where it's come from and how we consume it. So I will just start by talking a little bit about the agenda of my talk. So I'll talk about the Chinese origins of tea because not many people know that tea originated from China. Then I'll talk a little bit about the colonizers and how they came to China and how tea was basically taken from there. And then opium trade and war, which is a very integral part of colonial legacy in China, then Indian plantations, and sorry, I don't know why it says topic five, but yeah, and then modern day, of course, ramifications, legacies, etc. So there are many origin stories for tea, and I think a lot of them are legends because they are so heavily inculcated in Chinese history, ancient history. So there's one of Sean Teng, who was thought to be a doctor who was looking for a cure, and he poisoned himself, and from there he found a tea leaf, and that basically helped with the poisoning. There's the other of a Chinese emperor who was boiling water under a tea tree, and then the tea leaf fell in the boiling pot of water, and the rest is history. So there's a lot of those legends, and they form a part of the Chinese thought and legacy of ancient China. Tea was originally eaten. The leaves were ground up and eaten with vegetables. Until then, they discovered how to discovered with like boiling water, infusing, and etc. So it was originally eaten. And I thought that was a very interesting aspect. Not many people would be aware of that. I wasn't. So in the 9th century, Japanese traders, merchants, and monks, they were definitely doing trade with China. They were constantly going back and forth. And in the 9th century, they took tea back to Japan. So that's when the tea culture and the tea ritual started in Japan. The Chinese ones are almost 6,000 years old. So this is a very, very old concept. It's a very old product that we're talking about. It has a rich, vast, rich history. One of the misconceptions that people have is that tea is Indian or Sri Lankan, which is not the case. I mean, there are studies that show that the tea was grown, or there were some native aboriginal forms of what tea is now, but the modern day tea that we consume did not come from Sri Lanka or India, it came from China. And I will show later in this presentation how that how India and the Indian subcontinent became a part of that. So in early 1600s, as we are aware of the first wave of global colonization, expansion, imperialism, the Dutch traders were actually the first who took tea from China to Europe. And it was the Dutch East India Company that was the first one to do that. So the Dutch took it back to Queen Catherine of Braganza. And when she married King Charles II, that's when the tea drinking amongst British aristocracy, that's when it became a trend. They found that drinking tea had a lot of health benefits, and it made them, it definitely ameliorated some of the health conditions, because at this time, the Great Britain, Europe was a very was a very sick place. There were a lot of illnesses. There were a lot of issues, especially because opium was also coming into these countries and communities, and they found that tea would energize them, revitalize them, etc. So from there, the British East India Company followed suit and the competition grew. Of course, I mean, as history shows, the British East India Company was much more resource rich, and they were much more competitive. And so when the Dutch were going to the Chinese, the British East India Company wanted a piece of the pie as well. And so they started trading in as well. So the first thing that they did was, of course, like traded in legally, of course. But however, after a while, when the European tea culture emerged, when people were drinking tea left, right, and center, they realized that this is really expensive for us to continue using legal terms. And so it kind of like progressed to a little bit of a shady system. So what happened was tea then became to be treated with opium, which they were procuring from India and modern day Afghanistan, etc. So that's when they were kind of like going into Indian subcontinent as well. And instead of using, like doing a money trade or buying tea, they started doing a barter. Tea was China's top export, including silk and porcelain. And colonizers wanted to reduce costs. And by colonizers, I mean basically the British at this point, because they had really come through in terms of competition. So how did they reduce cost? Great Britain was increasing its imperial power in the world, and tea was astronomically popular, as I mentioned earlier. So they wanted to grow tea themselves. They wanted to have a better share of the market, so they don't have to buy it from the Chinese. As I mentioned earlier, tea started being traded for opium in India. When opium was first introduced to the Chinese market, it also, because it is very addictive, because it's you can get addicted to it really fast, very much similar to heroin today. It became very popular. Every back alley had an opium den. All that stuff was happening. So that's when the Chinese emperor in 1939 told everyone that this is enough. The effects on our citizens are absolutely horrible. So what we're going to do is we're going to destroy the British shipment. So the picture that you see is the British opium shipment being destroyed, set to fire, thrown off the ships, etc. This is what instigated the first opium war in 1839, because the British were furious because this was a huge market share. However, still at this point, tea was still only grown in China yet. So as the British established the Raj after they had officially taken over the government, tea plantations were brought from China to be planted in India, more specifically Darjeeling and Assam province. These had really good fertile conditions for growing tea. And because these were colonies, the British market share expanded, because they weren't, this was their land now, and they were just planting tea from China, and they were selling it back to Europe, even selling it back to China, selling it everywhere around the world. So the pictures that you see here, this is the first known picture of a tea plantation on my left, using slavery, indentured servitude, labor, etc. There's also a gender aspect here, because there were mainly women who were working on these plantations, women and children who were working on these plantations. So there's definitely a gender aspect to this colonization. Owing to the Indian tea plantation, Great Britain was able to achieve a European monopoly over tea. So, tea is the most, second most popular drink in the world with water at first place. I mean, we know we need water to survive. And tea is very much the second. Every culture, every geographic place has its own traditions of brewing tea, drinking tea. There's tea cultures. I also want to talk a little bit about the tea as a social drink. It is a culture. There's rituals. It is also a tool for diplomacy today. So a lot of diplomatic decisions, a lot of diplomatic actions take place over a cup of tea. It is every aspect of culture, every aspect of society, starting from classes to communities. Tea is very popular, but it is really important to know that the history of tea's global popularity is mighty colonial history. The other thing I wanted to talk about was how when the other presenters talk about India and Pakistan and other disputed areas in the world, tea has the capacity to be one of those binders, that one of those things that people can agree on. It is very, very popular in that sense. So the next time you reach out for a cup of tea, I hope that you will remember that the origins of tea, the colonial ramifications, and the colonial history. Thank you.